Thank you. Again, Naiel, Samaan, AI platform product owner.
The same, Valmir, Bucaj, platform product owner as well.
Awesome. So we're going to try to walk you guys through Forge's journey over the last 3 or 4 years, concentrating specifically on our ML platform. But before we get there, some facts about Ford. So founded 1903, 120 years old. Happy birthday, Ford. So very excited about that. In 2022, we sold 4.2 million vehicles. That's sixth worldwide. And if we get a little bit more details, the F-Series trucks are the best-selling vehicle in the US now for the past 41 years running. That is at least one F-Series truck sold every 49 seconds, second to only iPhone in terms of product sales. And then if we're talking about revenue, it generates more revenue than the NFL, NBA, NHL, and MLB combined. So quite a bit of value there. So what I want you guys walking away with this chat from is that we are at the cutting edge of applying AI ML across the automotive industry. And what I mean by that is Ford tackles a breadth of problems. So everything from connected vehicle to manufacturing to advanced driver assist systems, marketing, finance, supply chain, across the fold. And we're constantly sort of getting new and new use cases to apply to. We have had to navigate a lot of complex technical and organizational challenges beyond having to buy a one-size-fits-all solution, which is what most vendors and folks coming to us try to sell. We have to do a lot of legacy system integrations. So really working and integrating with many outdated systems. And we've had to coordinate across many cross-functional teams that are usually the size of small startups and getting them to maneuver and work with us to build MLOps platforms or use cases in the way that we're pitching them to. So where did we start? From a technical perspective, our infrastructure was not designed for machine learning. We had no integrated machine learning tool stack. We had a lot of IT rules that really posed huge machine learning problems, such as networking, security, everything across the fold that really did not align well with what we wanted to do. And then finally, there was a lot of teams that had legacy code that was not really machine learning optimized. From an organizational perspective, 100-year-old company, a lot of change management needs to happen. A lot of groups duplicated ML work, so certain aspects did not need to happen over and over. There's a lot of coordination that was needed for common machine learning patterns and tools, and then a huge lack of established MLOps skill sets and practices. So we've had to do a lot of training to help out with that. 3 years ago, we went down this path of addressing this problem. First thing that we did was we coordinated the talent. So we created Ford's Artificial Advancement Intelligence Center. It's a team of roughly about 100 ML and DevOps experts that we pulled in from all the various groups, which became the knowledge center within Ford. And we've been consulting on implementing key use cases. Once we did that, we created Mach 1 ML, which is our machine learning platform. And it does two main things. So one, tool offerings. So we investigate tools across the industry that we want to buy enterprise licenses for and hand them over in terms of training and application. Everything from compute cluster, so we have our own massive GPU cluster that we house within Ford. We also signed up for the cloud. Google Cloud is our cloud partner. Seldon Deploy, huge partner for us as well, and then Weights and Biases. In terms of ML platform, which is what Valmir is really gonna be concentrating on, and he's gonna give you guys insights about the various changes that we've had. It's a team of roughly 25 DevOps and machine learning engineers, and it's gone through multiple iterations. So I won't spend too much time on it because Valmir will talk about it, but we've gone from everything from on-prem, low-code, no-code system for new users. We've done cloud-based codable systems for machine learning experts, and then we've also done hybrid systems for varying types of users, which is where we're at now. And then finally, Gen AI, which is the big thing right now. We're not going to really talk about it today, but we do have, and we have many applications that we're trying to put into production right now. We haven't come up with a concise or something that we want to recommend to all of Ford yet until we prove it out with a few value use cases. But we do have a portal for the many Ford employees to use enterprise versions of ChatGPT, Palm, and then we also have our own deployed Llama 2 instance as well. So MLOps development kit. Before I hand it over to Valmir, 2 years ago, we came up with our guiding principles to build out our real machine learning platform. Some of the things that we really wanted to tackle was we're building for the machine learning practitioner. We wanted to make access to data within Mach 1 as seamless of an experience as possible. We wanted to simplify provisioning infrastructure and getting access to tools as easy as possible. Obviously, remove the complexity to implement machine learning pipelines. And then finally, everything that we built or we want to hand over is modular in nature using industry standards. So some of those key decisions included, how do we help with onboarding to machine learning tools, right? How do we integrate with existing systems, which is, again, one of the bigger problems? Are we going to go down a centralized or decentralized path, on-prem or cloud? And then finally, the tool stack. What are we going to use for orchestration? What are we going to do for deployment? What are we going to do for CI/CD? So that being said, let me pass it over to Valmir.
Thanks, Naiel. So let's start with the good stuff, right? So this is basically about, I want to say, 60 to 70% of the tool stack and architecture that we currently have. It's basically the current state of the platform, and it's still ever evolving. And as I said, it's about like 60, 70%, but it kind of like gives a core of what we are trying to build. And, you know, I've attended many talks and I was like, well, you know, I always wanted like other companies that were giving talks to just actually show their architecture and, you know, what are you building? Like, don't just speak on hypothetical terms and get philosophical. It's like, just show us exactly what exactly does your framework look like. So this is exactly about, again, 70% what it looks like. So there's still things in development that I've left out, but the core is this. And I'm going to come back and reference this as I go through the next few slides and I go over the key learnings over the many iterations that we've had. And I'll try to reference here where we sort of applied those learnings in coming to this state of the platform. But let me just spend 1 minute to kind of just walk you over a little bit what it looks like for a new user. So first off, there is different entry points for a user. There's typically like three kind of entry points. We kind of require, there's a soft requirement right now to have a GCP project like Google Cloud. So GCP, Google Cloud platform, just so that you know what I'm talking about. So we require that users have a Google Cloud project when they come to us. Probably very soon we're going to remove that assumption altogether. And so we have an abstraction layer as soon as you come in, like what we call a configuration engine that kind of gets you started. And there's different ways to go about it. So if you wanted just to start developing locally, there's a path for you to just do things locally. You don't want to bother with CI/CD. You don't want to even maybe create a GitHub repo. We'll help you set up, you know, your Airflow pipelines, and I'll talk more about that. But the current state of our platform is mostly based on Airflow, so you can just develop locally with Airflow. But the way you develop, because we have structured it so that you can just do minor configurations and put that pipeline into production like within minutes, basically, like hook up with CI/CD because we ship those to you with this configuration engine that we have there, so that you'll be able to go from local development to production within a couple minutes, basically. So you're able to connect to multiple data sources. So think of this, each of these steps as Lego blocks. So you take a walk and you pick a Lego block that you need to build your pipelines. So you can connect to data sources on-prem. So we have, again, still massive data centers on-prem, but you can also connect to data sources on the cloud since a lot of the data has migrated to GCP now. If you want to use compute on-prem, you can hit your on-prem clusters, GPU clusters for just the compute. But if you want to do the compute on GCP, you'll still be able to use Vertex AI, custom jobs, submissions to do your compute. And then if you wanted now to store your models either on-prem or on GCP, float point, quantized, like we can help you store those models. And finally, deployment, currently two deployment patterns, Seldon deployment, Vertex AI deployment. And you can have all of these steps as Airflow steps. All of this can be automated in a matter of hours, basically. Okay, so As I said, I'm going to start discussing some key learnings that motivated us to land where we currently land. And I apologize, I may have to go back and forth a little bit to that slide so that it's clear what I'm talking about. But one of the first things that we had to kind of tackle is this persona changes. I think quite a few speakers here mentioned this. You have to know who you're building for, right? So our initial iteration of our platform was targeting citizen data scientists. So we had this shiny UI. We didn't use shiny to build the UI, but you know, just like we had a UI, drop, click some buttons, upload some data. On the back end, like we had this fancy Argo workflow that was running on our on-prem Kubernetes clusters. And it was really cool. But again, if people don't use it, it's not a product, right? It's a cool thing, it's a cool toy, but not a product. So it saw some traction, but what we were noticing very early on is that many people, many teams want to have control over what they're building. Like they don't want things to happen over, you know, on the back end. They want to, you know, integrate with other, systems. They want to do highly customized, for example, just a training piece or where the data is coming from or where they want to deploy. And maybe they don't even like the pre-built servers that Seldon provides. For example, that's a problem we had to overcome. They want to build custom servers. They don't just want to build one custom server. They want to build like five different custom servers because they have five different types of model classes that they're trying to deploy. So what we did is, you know, then we started, well, you know, this is not working out quite well, so let's start actually targeting the mid-level to advanced ML engineers. And instead of building a pre-wired framework, let's just start by going on the other and build Lego blocks. Observe how these teams are using those Lego blocks, what are they building, and then later on start adding abstraction layers on top of those Lego blocks. So that was kind of like a learning for us, a bit painful, but it kind of got us to where we are. Onboarding. So again, so Ford is a large organization. You can never satisfy everybody if you try to build everything as a team. As you saw, we're about 25 or 30 people. Ford has over 70,000 white-collar employees. A great percentage of them are in this space trying to build ML products. So rely on company practices. So for example, for onboarding to Google Cloud, we extended what another team did, for example. We hook up into that. Also, in one of our iterations, so when we refactored our on-prem platform to the cloud, we had a built-in, like a baked-in requirement that if you want to onboard to GCP, not to GCP, but if you want to use our services, then you have to onboard with us to GCP. We had built like an onboarding pattern to GCP with us. And it worked fine initially because Ford had just started to move to Google Cloud. And a lot of teams were coming new to this. So if they heard about us, they would come to us and it worked fine. But again, so what we started to notice very soon is that there were especially mid-sized teams who were cross-functional and had some DevOps experience. They had already started to get onboarded on GCP with their own Ford, you know, GCP projects, and had already started to develop, you know, their pipelines in their own GCP projects. And at some point they needed XYZ from us, and they would come to us and say, hey, I want just this piece, that piece, and this piece. Like, how can I make that work? I mean, how can I get it? Our answer would be, well, you kind of have to onboard with us. So it didn't kind of age very well. So what we did is like, we're like, well, we have to kind of refactor our platform again so that we don't even require anyone to come on board with us, you know, to GCP. As long as you have a GCP project that you have created in a Ford environment, we want you to be able to use our services. Again, we moved to this even further modular, smaller microservices that we can ship to customers and you can use anywhere you want. And dev to prod. I think everyone here at some point has experienced this issue, right? How do you go from a notebook to putting a pipeline into production? We're not talking even just about models. Initially, when we kind of built the platform, even when we refactored to the cloud, we were like, well, you know, we are the team that will help you go to production. So we kind of didn't think too much about what that conversion from experimentation or the development stage looks like when you want to go to production. So what we found ourselves doing is a bunch of people would come with a bunch of notebooks with a code structured in all kinds of ways, and they wanted to use now our sort of starter kits, our platform to go to production. So it was a pain for us to help them hands-on refactor that code, restructure it in a way that you can kind of plug in into this framework and, you know, automate these pipelines and put them into production. So what we did, this has kind of landed us in this platform. So now when you come to us, you can start developing, you know, you can develop for as long as you want, but the upper diagram, right? So you start by us creating a structure for you so that you're starting to even write code with production mindset. So you're gonna write code from the very beginning with the idea that you're gonna put that code into production one day, right? Even if that day may be, you know, 6 months from now. So we restructure your folder in a certain way. We ship our CI/CD pipelines to you, our CI/CD packages, basically. We set up your Tecton namespaces. We create your Astronomer workspaces. Even if you want, we create GitHub for you. We create your GCP projects for you. And you can start iterating and developing for as long as you want. But when you are ready to go to production, then you do very minor configuration changes to to the CI/CD package that we ship so that you can send the pipeline from top to the bottom. And we try to track everything. For example, we also have built a metrics data lake that we automatically, for example, it's baked into our framework to collect metrics. Like if you're using our services, we will know about it. We don't care where you are using it. Are you using in your local machine, just in your laptop? Are you using in the GCP? Are you using in the Vertex AI workbench? I will know that you're using my microservice, basically, and I'll track it, and it will show some dashboard at the end, like what kind of that looks like. And okay, let's see. So another lesson, centralized versus decentralized. I kind of mentioned that a little bit. So our platform is mostly decentralized. So what do I mean by that? Apologize for this. I hope it's not giving you a headache. But so we notice that people want to own the services. You know, you go ahead and install, for example, Python, you install a package and it's kind of yours, right? You know, so you can do with it, nobody can take it away, kind of thing. But at the same time, so we wanted to kind of embrace that model. You know, we're gonna build Lego blocks that we ship to you, you own them, like you're the owner of those. You don't have to come back to us to ask for permission for anything. When we release updates, you get those updates. It's just a pool kind of those updates in. But at the same time, we didn't want our, you know, the data scientists and ML engineers to worry about managing tools. For example, we have centralized Seldon deployment, right? So we have one central Seldon deployment, but what we do, we create a namespace for you. So you have that separation, right? So when you get onboarded, we create your own namespace, so you own it. Similarly, like we have one deployment of Astronomer, right? It's like managed instance, but we create a workspace for you. So when you get onboarded, you have your own workspace, so that's just where your deployments go. You're not messing with anyone else. And similarly, for example, for Tecton, there's like only one cluster, and then we create namespaces for you. So it's mostly decentralized by centralizing some of these key tools so that you don't have to manage them. And let's see. So I think on-prem versus cloud. So this is another big one. So we were purely on-prem when we started because naturally we had a massive GPU cluster on-prem, so we had to utilize it. Then Ford signed a deal with Google. So everyone, you know, the cloud hype kicked in and everyone wanted to migrate to the cloud. So naturally we were kind of like at the spearhead of this migration. So we refactored our entire platform to be cloud first. And then guess what? People found out that because of our decentralized model, for example, if teams who are getting onboarded to GCP, they have their own project, so the billing goes to their teams. People found out that GPUs in GCP are very expensive. And that we don't want to pay. I need to use like 16, 20, 30 GPUs to train my massive deep learning models. Like, we don't have a budget for it. So like, we need to somehow be able to use the compute clusters on-prem, but I want to deploy to GCP. I have my data say on GCP. I want to still use services on GCP. So how do I do that? So for Airflow, I'm going to give you the secret sauce. So we built custom Airflow operators so that users can plug into their Airflow, and it's just a task. So when you're building these pipelines, we have custom Airflow operators for HPC batch, custom Airflow operators for Kubernetes on-prem. So when you're building your workflow, you're pulling data from GCP, you're doing whatever transformations you want, you're pulling data from BigQuery, but now compute. Do you want to do your compute on Vertex AI, or do you want to do your compute on-prem? It's as simple as using our operator, custom operator, and you just go on with your life. Then you want to quantize your model? Sure, great. So where do you want to store? Do you want to store in an on-prem, you know, store that's designated for a quantized model so you can later deploy them to edge devices? Or do you want to, you know, store them to, say, cloud storage and then deploy to Seldon? And it's basically plug and play. So for example, for Seldon, there was another talk that had created this model as a service. What we do is we have built a few custom Seldon operators that we hook into our pipeline, basically that work well with Ford infrastructure. So. And yeah, this is how you orchestrate your workflow. I'm running a bit low on time, so I'm gonna try to go a bit faster. Technical stack. When we first migrated to, this is an interesting one as well. So when we first migrated to GCP, our entire platform was built around Kubeflow pipelines and Vertex AI pipelines. What we found out is that it's very hard, you know, Vertex AI, for all of you who may know, is like an island. It's hard to communicate to anything else because of their networking issues. So people wanted to, you know, still connect to on-prem data, on-prem compute clusters. So we had to kind of, that was one major reason for us to move out of Kubeflow pipelines. I think it works well for many people. But also we liked Airflow. It's more Pythonic. It had like a lower learning curve, like entry point for many people. People just kind of didn't really like Kubeflow for whatever reason. Like a lot of people or customers we talked to within Ford just didn't really quite like Kubeflow. So because we also needed to connect to a lot of infrastructure on-prem, it was a good reason for us to, again, do another refactor of our platform where we pretty much rewrote everything with Airflow. Modeling techniques, I'll skip through that. So another one from here that I want to touch on real quick is team topology. So it was painful for us when we went from purely on-prem to the cloud because we had the team structure that we had for on-prem was not fit for the new product strategy. So we had this like three-team structure initially, like model team, data team, deploy team. So what we found out is that like a fluid reorg around objectives and key results is what really works well. So basically the objectives for your platform should drive the team topology, so that you can reorg anytime you want as long as your objectives change. So when your objectives change in 3 months, keep the team topology fluid so you can just regroup the people as you need and are best fit to work on those objectives. So here, this is like what some of our metrics tracking looks like. For example, we are able to track anytime you use our custom operators by skill team, by PDO teams, like the number of times you use them, whether you're using them in a local development environment or whether you're using them in production. These are the active users. I think the time window here was the last 2-3 weeks. Total use cases, like active use cases, since we refactored to Airflow. And I think Naiel can talk more about Gen AI.
Yeah, let's just take it home. So Valmir talked a lot about our MLOps platform. I'm going to talk about the larger aspect of tooling. So in terms of how we're affecting different folks, maybe they're not using our MDK platform. They're using some of the tools that we're offering. So we have about 1,500 AI builders across Ford. And those that are using LLMs, we're also keeping track of and trying to understand what they're doing. We have about 25,000 users there. Quite proud of that, especially over the past little bit. So what's next, right? I think Valmir touched on it. Customer support is very important. Do not skimp on that, right? Training, whether it's sort of getting your development team continually answering questions and helping people to try to get onboarded, very important. Hardening the platform. I think we've been talking to many folks here at the conference. Monitoring is very important and hard, right? Especially applying it when most folks don't want to implement it, right? There's no incentive essentially at their level to implement it. So we're trying to make it as easy as possible. So easier solutions are what we're going after. More generative AI. Again, we're not really talking about this in this talk, but lots of applications right now at Ford using Gen AI, and maybe at a later conference we'll divulge more of that information. And then finally, inner sourcing. 1,500 AI builders. We can't continually build specific features for each one of them or each of those groups. So we're inner sourcing a lot of our code base and having folks contribute to that code base so that they could build things that other people can share and reuse. So quite excited about that. All right, so just ending it off here. We have been leading a lot of AI innovation across the auto industry. We've overcame a lot of legacy tech and organizational silos, still are. We have been coordinating at scale across various groups within Ford. And finally, no custom solutions, right? There hasn't been one custom solution or vendor solution that's really served us that well. We've had to sort of retrofit it to make it work within Ford's ecosystem. So with that being said, just to sort of leave it open, thanks everybody, and we'll take some questions if anybody has any.
Did you use a feature store of GCP by any chance? Did you explore in that direction?
Yes, we have. Actually, we had a full aspect. One of our first things that we did was onboard people with a feature store, but it didn't really make sense on a per use case level. We think, and we've been sort of pushing it, if you want to implement a feature store, you got to implement it at the organizational level where they house their data lake, right? It shouldn't be the ML platform team that implements it for use case teams. So,
yeah, I'll just add to that. So one of the kind of downfalls that we found with feature store is because it kind of only sits in your GCP project. So what we really needed Google to do for us is create a feature store that you can access cross projects, so that we can, you know, generate features for, you know, centralized kind of feature store that people who are getting on board with different projects can just access and use them. So that was like a reason why it didn't really like age well, and people didn't really like the fact that they had to stand it up in their own GCP project. That in implementing like one or two use cases, they're like, why do I need to kind of worry about feature store? And the online serving of feature store is like super expensive too, so.
Just really quick. So with your architecture and your model supporting the citizen data scientists, what tools and techniques that you use to ensure quality assurance when it comes to deploying those solutions to support your community of developers?
Want to take that?
Can you repeat I think I missed the first part. Like you're
what
saying.
What tools and approaches that you use for quality insurance in your model to ensure that your developing communities, when they deploy solutions, that they were quality solutions, basically?
So within various groups within Ford, a lot of them have governance panels. So before deploying a model, the model that's been built, whether with Data Robot, which is one of the tools that we've offered, has to go through the governance panel. Variously checking everything that's been implemented before being put into full-scale deployment. I don't know if you want to add anything else to that. So.
No, I think that's probably captures it.
Thank you for the talk. I was curious to hear more about lessons learned from inner sourcing features that you mentioned. This is something I've been thinking a lot about lately, about how to, not just the idea, of course, sounds great, but how do you do it in a way that's actually successful without basically just stealing people from other teams full time and teaching them a whole new expertise that is not their normal job?
So that's a great question. I don't think, so we haven't implemented that at scale yet. At a very small level, what happens is our customers who are using some of these services, they do improvements, and then we just allow them to, you know, raise issues and submit PRs directly to our centralized GitHub repo. So at a smaller scale, like in like ad hoc cases, we have implemented it, but our goal is to actually just open the gates to pretty much almost anyone within Ford, at least initially. I think we had a question here, so I don't know. Yeah. And I also can't very well see over there because of the light, so.
Hey, first of all, I just wanted to note, I own a Mustang Mach-E. I've had it for a year and I love it. So I just want to shout out to you guys at Ford for making a great vehicle. It's really awesome. My question is really around adoption. So when I've worked on platforms like you're talking about, one of the biggest struggles is just getting people to use it instead of just continuing to work in their silo and do their own thing, because there's always this excuse of, you know, we don't have time to do that. We've got to get our release out the door, and there's always excuses. So How have you been able to convince people to actually adopt the platform?
I could take that. Yeah. So workshops, lots of workshops, and continually talking with them, but then also incentivizing them with things that their leadership are asking for, which is metrics, right? A lot of them don't really have the capacity to build a metrics dashboard that specifically calls out what they're doing and the value that they're bringing. So incentivizing them with other aspects that maybe they wouldn't have the time to build, included with their experimentation and deployment process. But circling back to what I originally said, workshops, a lot of workshops. So meeting with various groups and really understanding their problems and convincing them that we really care about their problems and we have a solution that could help them. So.
So driving adoption is probably one part of the problem. The second one, we're doing something similar, so I'm curious. The second part tends to be there are some areas where it's pretty clear that you should be doing this versus, say, the use case team, but then there's this hazy line as to who should do this. And is there like a very clean or clear philosophy on how that gets done, or is it resolved on a case-by-case basis?
There isn't. It's a lot of gray area.
I think we should say, I should add to that, that so our platform team has what we call like a sister Mach 1 ops team that works hands-on, takes projects hands-on. So if, for example, there is a team out there that needs development, like help with developing the project as well, the first kind of team that gets engaged hands-on is the Mach 1 ops. They, you know, if there's learnings from those engagements, and we take those patterns or those learnings and we try to build services. So, but it is a bit of a gray area. For example, now we're also trying to work hands-on with our customers because there's benefits of learning. You know, it's like there's nothing like walking the walk of your, you know, or walking in the shoes of your customers, right? So actually I'll have a couple of our teams hands-on work in, you know, specific business use cases for a few iterations and then come back and bring those learnings and build services for those common patterns.
I had one more question, which is, as you scale across the org, like on the very first day, you probably did not know what all the problems are that should be solved and what's the ideal way to prioritize them. So how did you start in terms of, in the early days, how did you figure out what the right problems to work on before you start scaling across the org?
Highest value, so prioritize from our leadership, right? Yeah, you have to prove it out first. That's essentially the path that we're still taking. So to win over various orgs, so I said that Ford is massive. Each of them has their own org essentially within that could build out their own platform. So convincing them, working with them and telling them that like we have the expertise to actually implement is what we're doing. So prioritizing the highest value use cases.
And it's more like understanding, trying to understand sort of the pain points and understand the current pain points, anticipate the need, and build services for that. For example, the idea of creating this hybrid workflow, we kind of got the ball rolling before we had any serious team come to us and say, hey, we need this. But in the last month or so, we have multiple teams, especially with LLMs hitting the block. They're like, hey, you know, I want to fine tune my model. Like, can't do this in GCP because it's like very costly. How do I do it? Like, I have workflows that I need to automate. Like, how do I use the, you know, compute on-prem? So it's more like talking to the customers, honestly. I think talk to them a lot, talk to as many people as you can, and try to anticipate basically what that need may be.
Hi, from NVIDIA. I appreciate the talk and learning about where you're coming from. I really enjoyed the partition where you're addressing this has been a long-standing journey, right? It took you're a long-standing company at Ford, 100 years. Bringing your company's workloads, data, infrastructure to the cloud more than likely was organized with a GSI, Global Systems Integrator, a Deloitte, a Capgemini, or an Accenture. Did you stay with that GSI through that journey and then guide them back down to being on-prem? Did you orchestrate that conversation with them to say, hey, we need a course correct because it's just too costly? And did you stay with that same team the whole journey from up to then back down and then come with this vision and you had to kind of course correct them? Or was it a communal engagement model? I'm kind of curious as like how that journey took place and how you led back them back down to what you really needed and what you architected, which is brilliant.
So we've been through many consulting agencies. We did not stay with one throughout it all, right? So we would have specific initiatives that we wanted to get done with them. get that done, and then maybe go a couple of months without them. And then if we find another initiatives that we wanted to implement, we'd bring on another one. So we never signed a long-standing engagement with any of them, whether it's Accenture, Slalom, so on and so forth. So,
thank you.
Yep. I don't see any more. So find us at the next table. I think we're
there's supposed to be like a hybrid cloud or on-prem hybrid cloud table. And if you have more specific questions around that, I think we may be there for a few minutes.
Awesome.
Yeah, thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Appreciate your time.